Okay. Yeah. Okay. Good morning, everyone, and welcome to this session. So let me first briefly introduce myself. My name is Dinesh, and I'm working for IBM Research for past many years. And prior to that, I was a student at IISc working in computer science department with Professor Narari. I did my master's and then PhD both from Indian Institute of Science. And in those days, we used to work in game theory and mechanism design because that was a very fascinating topic when all this internet economics was coming up, Google search engine was coming up and all those things. We saw a very exciting area in those times and then very fascinating journey we had actually. And today's time, this science has matured so much so that we kind of come and give the lecture like the forum like this actually, where young stars and some of these shining stars like you are coming up, and maybe you can get inspirations that how you take up a research field and then, you know, push the boundaries further. Okay, so with the brief introduction, of course, in today's time in IBM research, we are working on completely different things actually, but that's how the part and parcel of life is actually, right? In research journey, sometime you'll be working on one field, after a few years you'll be moving on to another field, come back to that field. You never know things how crisscross, what gets used where, etc. Okay, so let's start here. So today what I'm going to talk about is that non-cooperative games and Equilibria, and special thanks to Professor Narari and his students Mayank Bharadwaj and Amal Roy, who helped me prepare these slides. I don't see many of them here. Okay, let's start with the traffic problem. I'm sure all of you would have been victim of Bangalore traffic, right? Have you or not? I am at least, because coming from Hebbal, it took me almost 1 hour to reach here. Okay, so thought this is very apt example to start the discussion, okay? So what is this example all about? Let's say that there are three nodes, three junctions in a city, junction A, junction B, C and D, okay? And these links kind of depicts the roads, okay? This is the road network. It's a very, very stylized example, okay? Maybe a little far from reality, but I hope you will able to appreciate the kind of things which I'm going to talk in next 1.5 hour, okay? So what is happening here? So these are the road networks. So let's say this is the source and this is the destination. People want to go in the morning. These are the residential location. These are the offices. So most of the people want to travel from point A to point B, point B. Then there are two alternatives to them. Either go via this upper path or go via this bottom route actually. There are two possible routes, right? And they are free to take any route. So imagine that in the morning when you get out of your home, you want to go to office, you have two choice. Either take this route or take this route. Once you take this route, then you are done. You have to follow this path, no other choice, okay? All right, so what is the concern of each of the driver? So obviously each driver decides independently which route to take. There is no compulsion. You are free to take whatever you want. Also, the delay of the driver. So let's try to understand what is the quantity which matters to a driver in this entire problem. Every driver is more concerned about how much time will it take for me to reach to the office. Am I right? In the early morning. So let's try to understand what these numbers mean. So this number mean, for example, on this edge, this number says 45, which means there is a constant delay of 45 minutes. No matter how many people are traveling on the road, you will take minimum and maximum of 45 minutes. Let's say it's a freeway, highway, it's a very wide road. No matter how many people are driving, going from junction C to junction B, it takes 45 minutes for you. Same is with this case. However, let's say this road and this road, these are a bit narrow roads, and the time depends on how many fellow passengers are traveling with you, how many cars are there on the street, which is most of the time the case, right? So this is a finite capacity link, and that amount of time taken depends on X by 100, where X is the total number of people who are traveling on this link, or the total number of cars which are on this street. Same is the case with this case, okay? So let's analyze this scenario, okay? Let's take that there are 4,000 vehicles, including yourself. Put yourself into shoe of one of the driver. You are one of the driver among the 4,000 cars. I'm just picking up one number just to give an illustration, okay? And this is purely for the motivation purposes. Don't try to connect too hard with the real life, okay? That will be a little cumbersome at this stage actually. But let's start with in a baby step manner, okay? Suppose if I take 2,000, there are 2,000 drivers, you being one of them. Now, your dilemma is what? You need to decide which route to take. Okay? So how much delay you will incur if you take this route? 45, of course, is common between both the choices. It all depends on which route you have more number of passenger traveling. Am I right? Because this 45 minutes delay you will incur for sure if you take A to C route. Here, this 45 minute delay you will incur on A to D. So they kind of sets you back equally on both the choices, right? The only discrimination which you can make is in terms of how much time if you traverse on this link versus this link. And that depends completely on what? How many people are traveling on this link versus how many other people are traveling on this link. So what would be your choice? Suppose you are one of them, remaining 3,999 people you took. Just find out which link has more number of people. You avoid that and join the another link. Am I right? Just think, it's a very simple argument actually. Now, this analysis you are doing in your mind, but so is being done by other fellow passengers. Because everybody is identical in this setup, right? So every driver who is driving the car, assumption is that they are all intelligent enough. They are all doing this rational analysis and they can do this kind of analysis quickly in their head. If everybody does this kind of analysis, what do you think the overall behavior of the crowd would be? Where would they settle down? Any answer? Correct. So what would be? So suppose everybody keep doing this back and forth, right? I try this route. Let's say every day this is the game goes on, suppose, right? So, or I give you multiple chances just to hypothetically, then where would you guys settle down actually? So suppose all of you are participant actually, all of you are driving the car and each one of you is free to take the choice yours actually, right? Nobody can force you what choice you take. But what do you think finally, as a social behavior, as a collective behavior, what would it settle down to? Beautiful, right? Half the people will go this route, half the people will go this route. And at that point in time, how much will be the delay for every person? Can somebody tell me? So 2,000 people goes on this, 2,000 vehicles go on this route. So 2,000 divided by 100, 20 minutes delay here, 45 minutes delay here, 65 minutes delay. Each and every passenger is experiencing. Am I right? Now, if some guy tries to act smart, and let's say there are 2,000 cars which are going on this route, 2,000 cars going on this route. Even if the single one tries to move from this route to this route, hoping that they will be better off, do you think they will be better off? No, right? Am I right? So a unilateral deviation here, given that all my fellow passenger, each one of us have come to some kind of an agreement, implicit agreement, we have decided to split ourselves into two groups, then if I try to act smart unilaterally, it's not going to help me. It's going to not only hurt me, as well as also hurt the other fellow passenger if I try to switch my path. Make sense? Clear? If this is understood, I think my 80% job is done. This is where I'm going to lead to towards the end of my talk. And this was the beautiful idea behind Nash's Equilibrium. We'll come to that. Okay? I'm sure many of you would have seen famous movie Beautiful Mind, right? John F. Nash. So he is one of the, you know, star figure in this field. And his contributions are so important, you know, they are used each and every place. We'll hit that slowly. Okay. All right. So this is what the summary is, that if everybody goes here, then, you know, it should not be 85. Okay. So if there are 4,000 people and if 2,000 goes here, 2,000 goes here, the total delay will be 65. Okay. If everybody would have gone this route, then obviously that is 85 delay, which is not what you want, and because of which you will finally settle down at 65. Okay? All right. Now suppose government comes back and government thinks that there is a congestion problem because there are only two choices. Let me give little more choice to my citizens. Okay? And what they do? They construct a bridge or a new link they open between C and D. Okay? Now, the interesting story here is that, again, there is a zero amount of delay. It's a super express highway, okay, between C and D. So no matter how many vehicles are traveling, no matter what time of the day you are going, you will almost close to zero time it will be required to touch from C to D. Suppose that's the situation, hypothetically. Okay? Fine. Suddenly, if this happens, and you guys are currently traveling on this 2000-2000 split, what would you, how will you react, let's say? Suppose, should you decide to react, how would you react now to this situation? Do you think that there are some better options for you to improve your delay? So let's say 2000 people are going here, okay? So 2000 means how much time it is taking? 20 minutes here, 45 minutes here. Now, I am the only one who got to know about this information. Everybody else is still continuing on their route actually. Then what will I try to do? Suppose if I say that I go from here to here, see, obviously, note one important point. Even if all the passengers travel on this link, my total delay is 40 minutes. So I'm always better off taking this link as compared to this link because this will incur me 45 minutes. First point. So I take this route, go from here and go from here. Now currently what is happening? There are roughly 2000 people on the upper path, 2000 people on the bottom path. So how much will be my delay now if I switch this strategy? 40 minutes, right? Earlier it was 65 minutes, right? So what will happen? I'll say that, okay, I'm clever enough and I should go this route. Now, but suppose this information is made public, okay? And everybody knows about this information, right? And every driver tries to do that, Then what will happen? If every driver tries to take this route, then what will happen? 80 minutes. Suppose if all of you get crammed onto this path, then it becomes 80 minutes. Now, the important question is, even at 80 minutes, suppose everybody decide to follow this route. Let's take one individual driver. And now driver finds that, no, now this delay has increased because we were having 65 minutes. I tried to act smart and so did everybody. In that attempt, everybody ended up losing. Each one of us is experiencing now 80 minutes delay. So now shall I switch back to my original plan? Will it help me? Suppose you do that deliberation actually. So suppose if you don't want to take this route, you go back to this your original path. Okay? How much that delay would be? Because still mind you that all people are traveling on these two routes, in this route, right? So 40 minutes for sure here, right? So even if you decide to take, let's say, this route, because everybody is traveling on this path, you think that, okay, probably I may get better off by going from this part. How much it will be again? 85, which is higher than 80, at least. So this is the, fallacy here. In fact, this is the problem in many of the road network people identified, and this is famously known as Brass's paradox. Okay, I'll come to that. Sometimes we think that introducing more road network can help reduce the congestion, but here is an example, and we'll formally prove it, that there is no incentive for anybody to now switch this path. If everybody gets latched onto this route, even if I now try to help myself by switching the path, I am in a no better position, right? So each one of us is now suffering with 80 minutes delay as opposed to 65 minutes delay, which each one of us was suffering earlier when there was no such link opened actually. Okay, can you appreciate this thing actually? It's important, think about it. Game theory is all about simple things, but the subtlety involved into it actually, okay? So we'll come back to this analysis. So this is precisely called So what is now game theory actually? So this behavior of the individuals, so there is a set of collective agents. Why did I take this example? I now want to connect it to the game theory. The set of drivers here can be thought of as autonomous agents, okay? Or rational agents who have the autonomy, complete autonomy to take the decision, whatever they want to take, number one. Number two, they are rational. Rational, what I mean by rational, they always try to care about maximizing their welfare. It's not that I'm trying to make somebody happy and therefore even if I'm okay, if I make some loss. They are not like that kind of, entities. So as long as you have these multiple agents who are trying to take, who are autonomous and self-interested agent, and when they take collective decisions, nobody kind of, influences the decision of other, but where the ultimate utility or the reward which you get depends not only on your decision, but also the decision of your other agents, fellow agents, which is what was happening here. This is precisely the hallmark of this subject matter called game theory. So any, in real life, any situations or any problem where you can smell this kind of a flavor, game theory could be a tool or a way to go about it and analyze the situation and also take the design decisions. For example, if transport departments were to take the decision whether to build a road or not, whether to construct an extra link or not, even if to construct, with what capacity to construct, you can see that such analysis can be of great importance. In fact, it will be a dead investment. You have created a super fast link here. Obviously, this huge investment of government will go, but at the end you realize this is complete waste. In fact, it has done harm to the society than benefit to the society. Such things are not possible if you look at it in mundane eyes, actually. Okay? Are you with me? Okay. All right, so let's take another example. This is famous example in game theory. This is called prisoner's dilemma. And mind you, some of these examples are were invented by people like von Neumann and others, right? Who were earlier pioneer working on game theory. So no surprise that some of them have the flavor of this Western culture, actually. Typically, you won't find in India. This is one of those examples. But we have tried to Indianize this version because the rules and the regulations there, when somebody is, somebody is like put in the jail and how the court trial goes, the rules are little different than country like ours. So this example is coming from that scenario. Try to understand. So there are two people who have been suspected for certain crime and put in the jail. Okay. These are called prisoners, prisoner one and prisoner two. Now, what happens is that because the jailer does not know who is the real culprit, actually. So they put each one of them into separate cells in the jail, and the police officer goes and interrogate each one of them independently. They can't see to each other. They can't talk to each other. Okay? But both of them have been accused, right? So the dilemma of police officer is to find out who is the real culprit, actually. Okay? Police officer has no other evidence, actually. So here is the game setup. So both the prisoners are in separate cells. Police officer goes and interrogate each one of them and gives them two choice. That do you confess or you don't confess about the crime which has been committed? Your choice. You tell me whether you confess or you don't confess. Same question is being asked for the other, prisoner. And this is the rule of the game which has been set up and explained to both. So officer says, I am going to ask independently each one of you whether you confess or not confess. And depending on what choices each of you prefer, this is the number of years of jail you have to serve, actually. Okay, that's why we have put minus. So both of them don't confess, both of them goes to 2 year jail. Because in this case, he is clueless that who committed, right? So just put them in 2 years jail. Both of them, if confess, both of them goes to 5 years jail. Because both have confessed, at least one of them has committed the crime. If one confesses, other does not confess, the person who is not confessing, so here in these two numbers, the first number denotes the serving period for the row player. So these are the two players, okay? Or the two prisoners, row and column. So the first number denotes how many years the row player has to serve in the jail, and the column, the second number denotes how many number of years the column player has to serve in the jail, okay? So when the row player does not confess and the column player confess, the row player goes to 10 years of the jail, okay? And the column player gets away with only 1 year of the jail. I mean, seems a bit unfair, but that's how some of the laws are in Western countries, okay? And this is the symmetric, okay? Now, I don't want you to be ever in this situation, but let's just say for the sake of analysis and this subject, put yourself into a situation of one of these prisoners, actually. What would be your choice, actually? Right? I'm asking, because you cannot talk to the other guy. You do not know the other guy, what choice the other guy is going to pick, confess or not confess. What would you think? I mean, what would you pick? Any guess? So let's say I am this player, suppose. I put myself into the shoe of this player, actually, and think through. Now I ask this question, if I pick this choice, no confess, I have no control whether the other player will pick confess or no confess. I don't know. So if I go with this choice, which is the first row, I'll either end up in 2 years of the jail or 10 years of the jail, right? On the other hand, if I confess, I'll end up in 1 year jail or 5 years jail. I don't know. In either case, I don't know how many years it would be. It's just that it will be 1 year or 5 year. Here it will be 2 year or 10 year, depending on what he picks. Does it give any clue to you? Should give you a clue. I almost give you the answer. Huh? What? Confess. Yeah. Speak. Don't be hesitant. That's what I want to bring out. Okay. So what would you pick? Confess, right? Because obviously you know that no matter what choice he takes, what decision he takes, if you take confess versus not confess, your amount of serving will be higher. For example, if he goes with no confess choice, you will end up 2 year jail as opposed to 1 year jail. If he picks confess, you will end up 10 year jail as opposed to 5 year jail. So, isn't it clear that no matter what other is doing, you better go with confess? Exactly. Very nice. Okay? So other person will also think exactly the same because it's a very symmetric game actually. Yeah, I mean, you just flip it around, it's exactly identical situation. So he will also go with, so if I am a rational person and I know that I'll never get a chance to talk to my, this, I shouldn't call it fellow prisoner, but yeah, whatever the other choice is. Okay? In that case, better for me is to go confess and for him also confess, in which case we both end up into sure shot 5 year jail. Whereas, was a solution which could have been 2 year jail for each. But what is the risk? Why we are not going to take? Because I'm not allowed to communicate with this. So this is the price we both have to pay. So this is the risk factor I'm having in mind because I cannot communicate, I cannot talk to the other person. So rather than risking my life for 10 year jail, I'm better off going for 5 year jail than in the hope that I'll get only 2 year jail. Right? You get my point? Because if I take this choice, there is a chance that I'll end up into 10 year jail, which is like 8 extra year I'll have to serve than what I was targeting for. Here I know with sure shot, with 3 more year extra jail, I will be off. Okay? So this is the problem. Okay? So what is happening here? This is another situation where if you do game theory analysis, then although the outcome or the collective behavior of the agents may sound, not socially optimal, right? Because this is not a socially optimal solution. Both are hurting each other, but there is no choice, right? The same situation applies for the nuclear race, India and Pakistan, or any two country for that matter you take, right? Do you think the wars are so frequent? No, right? So suppose, consider Ro is one country, India, and this is Pakistan. It has strategy, whether to invest in nuclear arms or not. Because heavy investment goes actually, right? But still, both the countries invest actually. Why? Because if one country does not invest, and the risk which we have in mind is, what if other country invests in the nuclear race? We are gone. Am I right? So this is precisely the example you can cook up with actually, that if one country goes for nuclear race, another does not. And you can put down these losses, right? What if the warfare happens actually? How much loss which country will incur? So therefore, this is the live example. In real life, the government end up spending huge amount of money for something which is very rare to happen. But that's the reality of the life actually. Okay? Able to appreciate this? Okay, let's move one more example. Okay? And I'm sorry, I'm going by example. I don't know because I was told that you have very heterogeneous set of students, different background. Some people who are very math savvy love to see only Greek and Latin. Just hold on for a minute. I have a few slides for them. But I thought to start with this introduction to, warm up and have everybody in a one flow. Okay? Yeah, please. Can you repeat this? Mm-hmm. Sure. Sure. Agree. So I think you are going. What? Complete your question? Okay. Very good. So see, actually, because I thought this is a very first introductory lecture of the game theory. So the point which you are raising is a little bit advanced point, actually. We do talk about towards the tail part of this course. What do we say is this is a very fairly advanced topic called, you know, bounded rationality or non-rationality. So what if you break down this assumption? So that's why I have been very silently avoiding this topic, because don't want to confuse the whole set of audience. Here we are making this simplified assumption, which I agree that in real life, it, how many driver can make such complicated calculation, right? Very, very, very unlikely actually. So in that case, not many people are rational and intelligent enough to do all these calculations. So we are making these assumptions for this classroom purposes, because at some level, at least they help. For example, this nuclear race actually. There we can assume that both the countries have top-notch, you know, advisors, defense advisors who can at least do this kind of analysis and advice to the government. In that case, you can decide what should be your posture actually, right? There are many other scenarios. I'll just tell something called auctions actually. Use stake, right? So IPL auction, your IPL, that's another example of game theory actually. How much you bid for which player actually. Use money is involved, okay? Okay, let me quickly give last example, and I'm giving you because it is a favorite example of Professor Narari. He used to always give to us in the class. So there are two students, okay? I don't know how many of you are familiar with this place called MG Road in Bangalore. It's a very fancy kind of a place, okay? Many student youngster used to like to hang out. We also used to go there. Of course, I don't go now because it's a hugely crowded place, okay? So then there are two students, and they want to meet with each other and spend time with each other, okay? And the choice with them is that either meet and spend time at ISC or meet and spend time at MG Road. And probably in today's time, it will be better if you spend time in ISC. It's a green, lush campus. So your happiness level could be 100 and 100. If you meet on MG Road, your happiness level could be 10-10, let's assume. And if you one person goes at another place, another person goes at different place, obviously you won't be able to meet. So let's say the purpose is not solved, in which case the utility is zero. Okay. So in this case, what do you think would be the strategy actually, right? So this is not the case which is like previous example, right? You can't, so let's assume that these two can, they don't have cell phone and they can talk to each other, they can't coordinate, etc., etc., okay? And they just have to decide, okay? So if they have to decide, obviously this is not the case like previous example, like 100 is greater than 0, 0 is, 100 is greater than 0, but 0 is less than 10. So that, this is a little different example. You can't apply the same trick actually here. Same with the column, right? So here, something different you have to think. Okay? So the question now becomes is, here, obviously we will see later that this is one of, there are two equilibrium. Okay, both MG Road, and ISC is equilibrium. Okay? But then there is no pure strategy, both are equilibrium actually. And then sometimes what happens is, if there are multiple such equilibrium, that's also problematic. Because which one should you take actually? Okay? So let's see if time permits, we'll talk, okay? All right, so this is one example I would like to highlight. This is called geospatial exploration. So I don't know how many of you have heard, there was this something called DARPA Red Balloon Challenge in the year of 2009. So DARPA is one of the very, I mean, central federal government funded organization in the United States, like our DST and our DRDO. So they are funds various defense project. And this was a very important project funded. The goal was this. So they had this 10 red balloon, this weather balloon, right? Which you can see from distance. They are like in air in some height actually. So 10 red color balloon, they had, you know, very secretly they had placed at 10 different locations actually. Okay? And then the open challenge was that they invited all the top universities, MIT, Stanford, everybody, and they asked them that come up with whatever strategy you want and get us the exact latitude and longitude of each of these 10 balloons, and whichever team comes to us in the fastest manner will be declared as a winner. Okay, you coordinate, you mobilize your entire workforce or whatever force you have across the continent of United States. Why was this project funded? It has a deep connection with, you know, this terrorism actually. Okay, so basically some of these things, especially some countries invaded with, let's say, terrorism, and you have to comb the entire country within quick period of time to identify where the terrorists are hidden actually, right? In those situations, no device. You cannot travel the whole United States by flight and then keep watching and all. That won't work simply, actually, right? What you need is coordination among the people. Within a quick fraction of a second, imagine that Mumbai incident where the terrorists were all on the streets, actually. What can do? Only the social media and the communications among people can help us spot, nail down then and there itself within no time. That was the motivation behind this project. So why I'm bringing out here, MIT was the team who won this challenge, and they came up with very nice incentive idea, where what they said is that, you know, there will be a one root node, a person who will recruit friends of him. You go and recruit your friends, the friends will recruit their friends, okay? And whoever spots the balloon, they will put in the system, I spotted, the latitude and longitude. And then what happens, from bottom up to the top, this is like a tree. They gave the highest reward to the root node, to the leaf node, the half of that reward to the person who recruited the person, like that half. So it's a geometric series, actually, right? So very beautiful idea. I will encourage you to go and read about it. I cannot spend more time. This is probably the last example, the Google, right? Where does major revenue of the Google comes from? Advertisement. What is that advertisement? This is called sponsored search advertisement. So you see the typical, this is multi-year old, probably snapshot of Google page. So these right-hand side clicks, these are called, you know, organic results. These are called sponsored links, actually. So whenever a user makes a search query, Google finds certain advertisers. So let's say this is a weird picture, but suppose each of them is an advertiser who have, you know, submitted a bid to the Google requesting that please show my ad whenever some relevant user searches for the query, right? So what Google does, look at this Christmas is some query, and then it shows multiple ads of the different advertiser. So the problem of Google is to decide which advertiser's ad it should place, right? So there is a competition among these advertisers. Now advertisers submit a bid. In the sense, they say that I am willing to pay this much amount of money if you place my ad and if the user clicks on my ad. Okay, these are called clicks-based search, click-based payments. Okay, so lot more game theory goes in terms of designing these kind of systems, actually. It's a very, very, very important engine for Google, actually. Even a slight change can make a huge fall or increase in their revenue. So look at extremely carefulness. Big teams are devoted for that, actually. Okay. All right, the last example, this is called matching markets. So typically we have seen many agencies, right, who does matching. For example, in the United States, typically students are matched to the college by some automated admission system. Doctors are matched to the hospitals, okay, during their residentship. Farmers are matched to the consumers by various systems, Mandi and all you have seen. And the more popular is your marriage bureau, right? Brides are matched with the grooms, actually. You have many of these services in the market, right? So many of these things have to take into account the preferences of both the sides, actually. Each one of them have certain preference that which one I like, which one I don't like. And then the matching is sustainable if both the partners are happy with each other, right? Whether it is doctor with the hospital or whether it is employees with the company or a student with the college, right? But your goal is to maximize such happiness in the society such that this matching remains at equilibrium point, actually, okay? So there also equilibrium come, okay. With this brief introduction, with all these examples, let's go a little formalism. So now what we are going to talk about is strategic form games and Nash equilibrium. These are the two central cornerstones of this entire topic, non-cooperative game, which I'm wanting to talk. By the way, the next talk will be one of my colleagues who will be talking about cooperative games. So it's my duty to mention what is so this word non-cooperation means here. The non-cooperation essentially means that these agents, as I told you, right, these two prisoners are not allowed to talk to each other, right? Neither, if you're allowed to communicate with each other, they may probably cooperate with each other, and each one of them would have taken this NC strategy, right? But because they are not allowed, everybody is independent and autonomous. That's why this branch of game theory is called non-cooperative game, okay? In a very loose sense. All right. So it's worth to highlight two gentlemen over here, von Neumann and Morgenstern. These were the two pioneers who started this game theory way back around in some early 90s, okay? And they had put up the foundation, early foundation. So they had come up with, you know, they analyzed the two-player game, the simple setup where there are only two players, not the N player, okay? And then how do you analyze the equilibrium behavior of such games? we'll look at that. Okay. So first, let's introduce some formalism. So here are the people who needs some of these doses. Actually, please wake up now. Okay. Some who are from maths background, you may now like it. This is a formalism. So we define a game, a strategic form game, is a tuple which comprises of three component. N, this is the set of the players. For example, in the case of prisoner's dilemma, it was comprising of the two prisoners. In the case of traffic network, this was comprising those 4,000 passengers, whatever it is, right? This SI, what is SI? SI is a set. For each of the player, there is a set actually. And this set is called a strategy set. So essentially, these are the choices, various actions or the choices which you have, which you can take, okay, which you can make. Am I right? So can you correlate this now with the examples which I showed you, right? In the case of prisoner's dilemma, what would be SI? Confess or not confess, right? In the case of traffic, it will be whether take the upper path or a lower path, right? All right. So there are these sets for each of the agents. If there are N players, for each player, you need to have this choice set or strategy set actually. And without loss of generality, they need not be identical. It just so happened that in some of the example which we talked about, the choice set was identical for all the players, right? But without loss of generality, it need not be identical. It can be any set, okay? But it's a finite set. So I'm talking only about finite games. There is this another branch called infinite games, where you know, the choice set could be infinite. It could be some Euclidean space. I'm not going into that. Okay. Then another important component, UI, it is a function which maps the Cartesian product between these choice sets across all the agents to a real number. Okay. So what does it mean, Cartesian set? Which means every possible combinations of the choices taken by all these agents. Am I right? For every possible combinations of the choices taken by all these agents, you want to attribute some real number called utility of that agent. And mind you that this function UI is there for each agent, each of the N agents. So there are N agents. For each of the agent, there is a function. And this function could be different for each agent. Again, in the previous two example which we took, what was the UI? What was analogous to UI? UI was those numbers, right? In those matrix which we had filled. The first numbers in the matrix was corresponding to the U1. Second number in that matrix was corresponding to U2. And it was symmetric. Just so happened it was symmetric. But without loss of generality, it need not be symmetric actually. Okay? So these mappings are called as utility functions or payoff functions. We treat them as utility functions, which means the goal of each of the agent is to maximize it. And that is why we wrote the negative in front of those number of years of serving in the jail. We put that negative. Right? Because if you put that negative, then it's like a negative utility. So still your goal is to maximize that. So minimizing the number of years to serve in the jail is equivalent to maximize those negative numbers. So without lot of generality, from now onward, we will consider these payoffs or utility in positive sense, in the sense that goal is to maximize it. I could have taken loss view also, in which case goal of each of the agent is to minimize, but we will stick to this kind of assumption or framework. Okay, so now how the strategic form game is defined? So this we talked about. So what is the typical strategy profile? So let's say small S1, small S2, and small SN. These are the specific, in some scenario, let us say agent 1 went ahead and picked choice small S1. And this small S1 is a member of capital S1, mind you. Same with S2, which is a member of capital S2, and so on. So this kind of a profile, this is called pure strategy profile. Will you remember this term, tiny thing? It's called pure strategy profile. Each of this is called pure strategy of agent 1, pure strategy of agent 2, pure strategy of agent N. When you put them all together in this tuple form, this is called pure strategy profile, which is like jointly, which action each one of you have decided. Fair enough? Because soon when I go into some of those things, this term you may get confused. So better register in your mind for now. Maybe sounding simple, okay? So capital S is the set of strategies. For example, in the case of prisoner's dilemma case, let us say, what was the capital S1? Confess, comma, non-confess, right? Is there a chalk here? Okay. So for example, S1 was C and NC. So was S2. Okay. So this is the set of all possible alternatives which you have at your hand. You get my point? For example, in the case of that traffic example, right? So we had this A, B, C, D. Right? So for any player here, for any driver, the choices are what? Either take this route C or take this route D. Right? So either you take this route or you take this route. So you have two choice. Now, small s means which one have you taken on some day? That's what it means. Is it clear? Okay. So, if you look at these Cartesian products actually, these Cartesian products will be what? So, for example, in this case, S1 cross S2, capital S1 cross capital S2 will be equal to what? This will be all possible combinations, right? For example, CC, CNC, NCC, and NCNC. And each of them is called pure strategy profile. We say profile. Okay, each one of them. Is it clear? What does this mean? Okay. Now, we have this another interesting notation called S minus I. What does S minus I means? S minus I means that you just take this ith agent out of the picture and then take the Cartesian product of everybody but for the ith agent. Which means that it tells me that what are all the possible ways in which everybody other than me can behave. Do you agree? For example, in the case of this traffic network example, S minus I, if I am the ith driver, S minus I comprises of set of all different ways in which the remaining 3,999 fellow passengers can take the routes on a given day. Fine? Make sense? Clear? So this S minus I is important. So therefore, what you can also do is, you can also write a particular given strategy profile as small si, comma small s minus I. So for example, in this case, so let's take this case. Here S minus 1 is nothing but S2 because the only leftover agent is S2. But if there were one more agent, you could have taken the Cartesian product of that also. Similarly, small s minus 1. What is small s minus 1? So when you take a small s, so small s will be nothing but some action taken by agent 1 and agent 2. So suppose if you take S minus 1, this S minus 1 will be in this strategy profile, remove the agent I, the agent 1, and whatever is the leftover specific decision taken by the rest of the agent, that is called S minus 1 or S minus I, small s minus I. Is it clear? Okay. So now, so where SI is capital SI and S minus I is capital S minus I, right? Because capital S minus I is the set of all possible ways in which everybody other than me can behave. Yeah. Sorry? Can you speak a little louder? I'm not able to see. For now, it's just one shot actually. It's a one shot. It's a finite game. It's a one shot game. We are not talking repeated game. Yeah. Yes. Okay. Now, so let's talk about something called best response strategy. So in non-cooperative games, what you have to first, how do you analyze the non-cooperative game? Because you have no control over your opponents, right? So the question to ask would be, given that all my opponents have taken some strategy, it's like how is happening in politics, right? Suppose opposition has taken certain stand actually. I have no control what decision they will take, right? What other prisoner will take? Whatever decision they have taken, in that circumstances, what will be my best response strategy? Suppose if I keep that ready, let's say, okay? This is what is called as a best response strategy. So for example, for any strategy profile S minus I, suppose my opponents have taken S minus I, put all them together in collective manner, they have decided to go with the S minus I decision, then we say that my decision SI is the best response to this choice of opponents if my utility is maximized. So look at this expression. Here S minus I has been claimed on both the sides of this inequality because opponents have decided what they want to go with. Now it is choice in my hand whether I go with SI or whether I go with some other choice of my decision, SI prime. So if SI is some strategy which gives me the maximum benefit over all possible alternative strategy of mine, SI prime, then such a strategy SI is called as a best response strategy of mine as against S minus I strategy chosen by my opponents. And for each S minus I, this could be different, possible. For each S minus I, depending on what S minus I my opponents chooses, I have to react according to that, right? So if you go back to that business dilemma example, right? So let's take back this business dilemma example. So here we had this NCC. Here we had -10, -10, -5, -5. Okay. Am I writing correct? -2, -2. Okay. Here was how much? Is it -1 here? Yeah. Let's just see. Yeah. So -10, -1, -1, -10. Okay. We'll keep this example because this is a useful example to eyeball all the time. In this case, what is the best response strategy concept? Suppose somehow I know that my opponent, I am here. This is I am. Okay. I am this row player, okay? He is my opponent, the column player, suppose. So let's just write down this. So suppose somehow I get to know that my opponent is taking NC strategy. Then what would be my best strategy in that case? Suppose I know. In which case, in this case, my strategy would be C. If I know that my opponent has decided to take C, then my best strategy would be C. So this is the notion of best strategy. That's a different issue that you will never get to know what others have taken in non-cooperative game. But we write this formalism for the purpose because we want to go head towards the Nash equilibrium concept. Okay? There. So I was told that some colleagues are going to prove this Nash's theorem in the afternoon, and because of which I am giving you this paraphernalia so that you should not find it lost when they give you the formal proof of Nash's theorem using Sparner's lemma and etc. Okay, so this setup is clear. Okay, let's move on. Now, so best response strategy we talked about. Okay, now comes this strong dominance. So this is where the formalism is, what we saw in the case of Prisoner's dilemma. So there is this notion called strongly dominant strategy. Okay, what is the meaning of a strongly dominant strategy? A strategy SI star is said to be strongly dominant for player I if it strongly dominates every other strategy SI. So read this very, you have to be very careful while reading this actually, okay? What it says, no matter what my opponents are taking the action, it says for all S minus I, no matter what my opponents are deciding to pick the strategy, I am always better off picking SI star as opposed to SI, and no matter which other SI I take, okay? So very strong statement. No matter what my opponents do, okay, I am always the best if take SI star. As opposed to any other choice other than SI star will not going to give me better benefit. It's a very strong case. For example, in this case, this strategy C, suppose I am here. Look at this C. If irrespective of which one my opponent takes actually, this strategy is always going to give me higher payoffs than this strategy. Can you see that? So this is called a strongly dominant strategy for the row player. You can argue in the same way that this strategy is strongly dominant strategy for the column player. Why? Suppose if row player decides to take this strategy, look at the column player's payoff. If row player decides this strategy, column player is always better off from minus 2, minus 1, less number of years of serving. If role player decide to go with C, again, with going with this choice, the column player is better off. Make sense? So this is called best response strategy of the column player. This is also best response strategy of the role player. Not best response, sorry, strongly dominant. I'm sorry, this is not best response. This is strongly dominant strategy. This is also strongly dominant strategy for these two players. And therefore, you can see that if each player has such a strongly dominant strategy, then tell me, is there any incentive for anybody to take any action other than that strategy? No, right? So automatically, that profile of such a strategy will constitute the crowd behavior or equilibrium behavior. Am I right? And that is what was happening here. This is a strongly dominant equilibrium. Okay? But such behavior may not exist in all the game. If I change these numbers a little bit in this picture, probably this may be no more strongly dominant strategy. Right? Is it clear? Yeah. Very good. So look at this. That's what I said. This inequality holds true no matter what is S minus I. Okay? Whereas if you go to this best response, I'm not writing for all S minus I. Okay? For a fixed S minus I, I have some strategy SI which is my best response. But if my opponent tomorrow decides to go in some different way, I may probably have to go in a different way, which is give me the best payoff. But here, the beauty of this setup is that no matter how my opponent decides to go, I am always better off. My life is easy, actually. But this may not be the case in all the real-life games, actually. This particular game, it just so happened that this characteristic is true. And if this is true, then analysis is over. The problem is very simple. What you do? You first check in a given game whether there is a strongly dominant strategy of each player or not. If it is, then you are done. You can go home and have coffee, right? Just say that, sir, this is what we expect the crowd to behave. If they are left exposed in isolations and they are all rational, intelligent, if you leave them in a room, let them take decision, but they cannot talk to each other. This is how I think they will, I predict that this is how they will behave. That's it. And which is right prediction, actually. Cannot be anything other than that. Make sense? But if that is not the case, suppose if that is not the case, my numbers don't look like, for example, I don't know, maybe I just change it, let's say, I mean, for example, just to make it, I make it what? Minus 4? I make it more attractive, especially in this case, right? Then it's no more true. It's no more strongly dominant for role player. Now, for him, still it is a strongly dominant strategy, right? So there is another line of argument you can do in this. Because you know that this player, so how the role player will analyze? Although for role player, this is not a strongly dominant strategy, but role player knows that for opponent, this is still a strongly dominant strategy, right? So, role player know the column player will pick this. Because column player can't take risk. This is the first line of argument. So therefore, I should go with this one. Right? But now, put yourself into the shoe of a column player. Column player thinks that role player will think like this. And he will go with NC. Right? Then I am better off to go with NC actually. Right? But again, now role player will think that column player will do this much analysis. So this is called, iterative analysis, okay? This is like, so there are this formalism, I'm not going to go into that. This is called complete information versus partial information setup, and that how many rounds of such arguments goes back and forth. But in the simplest scenario, we assume that agents are so intelligent enough, they do this kind of infinitely many times argument. Like, I will think that what you will think that I think, actually. That what you think, right? I mean, it goes infinitely. Then only this equilibrium makes sense, actually. But there are something called anyway, let's not get there for now. Okay, so now a strategy profile is called as a strongly dominant strategy equilibrium if for each player this SI star is a strongly dominant strategy. Simple enough, right? And this is an example. Fine? Okay. So if we are using word strong, there should be a region, right? Which means I have to use word weak somewhere, right? Otherwise, there's no need to use word strong. What is weak dominance, right? So there is a slight difference between weak dominance and strong dominance. So strategy SI is said to be weakly dominated by another strategy if the following thing happens. So look at the subtle difference actually. So here what is happening is that no matter what my opponents are doing, there is some strategy SI prime which is at least as good as SI, okay, which is as good as SI, and 1 minute. Yeah, so first of all, it has to be as good as any other strategy. Not only that, there is some strategy to which it is strongly dominating. There should be some scenario of my opponent in which I am strictly better off. You get my point? See, in the previous case, what did we say? No matter what my opponent take the action, going with SI star will give me no less benefit than taking any other strategy, and no matter what others do. Here what we are saying, exactly the same thing up till here. Up until here, same thing. But then we are adding one extra disclaimer. We are saying that there exists some scenario of behaving of my opponents under which this will indeed give me strictly better payoff, right, than taking any other strategy. So for any other alternative strategy, if I choose, I can give you a situation of my opponent's behavior in which that will hurt me. You get my point? So this is little twist actually. So in the previous case, we said that no matter what you do, if I have these two choice, left hand choice and right hand choice, left hand choice, if I say that is strongly dominant, means no matter what all of you take the decision, if I go with my left hand, it is going to be no worse than my right hand. Okay? But if it has to be weakly dominant, then I have to tell you that this is true. Not only that, there is some particular instance of behavior of all of you. I am treating all of you as my opponent just for illustration's sake. So there is some instance of behavior of all of you in which by going with left hand is strictly better than going with this actually. Make sense? That's the difference. Okay. I mean, this is more for definitional sense I am introducing because maybe other speakers may require them. So therefore, it's my duty to introduce. Probably I may not use it beyond this definition in this talk. But keep in mind so that you should not get confused tomorrow if next speaker comes and uses these phrases actually. Okay? Okay, so what is weakly dominant strategy equilibrium? Exactly the same definition. It's just that each of these strategies is a weakly dominant strategy for each of the player. Okay? There is this also called very weak dominance. Let's not get into there. I mean, that's fine actually. This I may not need it. Okay? Okay, so this we just saw. I'm revisiting this prisoner's dilemma example. So this CC, this is a strongly dominant strategy equilibrium, right? We just saw that actually. Okay. Now comes the pure strategy in action equilibrium. What if such kind of dominant strategy, weakly dominant strategy do not exist, right? And if you put all this player to interact with each other and take their decision, what behavior they will settle down at? That was the question which was investigated by people like von Neumann earlier in the simpler setting of two players game. Later on, this beautiful work by John Nash, right? So I think he was at Princeton at that time and his guide was Tucker. And some of the people who are from optimization literature, you may be knowing this Kuhn-Tucker condition, Karush-Kuhn-Tucker conditions, right? For primal dual when we study actually. So he was his advisor, you can see. I mean, you would have seen in that movie also. So like, I mean, they are at a different plane. I mean, this was like a stroke of genius actually to come up with this idea. Prior to this, this game theory, initially it started with some of the work, but then there was a cold season for a long time actually. After the Nash's result, suddenly interest got, you know, imbibed that lots of many things took place. And more than that, when the internet came into the picture, there were plenty of applications where game theory becomes very natural candidate choice to use for analyzing those application scenario and design those scenario. I gave you a few, right? Companies like Google actually. Their revenue depends on some of this understanding of these topics actually, okay? All right, so let's try to understand what is Nash equilibrium. So Nash came up with this idea. So he says that let's take a strategic form game. It's a finite game. When I say finite means number of players are finite. Each of these player takes a finite number of choices they have at their hand actually. So each SI, which is the set of strategies, is finite in number, okay? And UI is the utility function. So if there exists a strategy profile when I say strategy profile, we already saw what is the strategy profile. If there exists a way of taking action by each one of them, this is called as pure strategy Nash equilibrium if the following happens. What is following happening? And mind you that there is nothing like for all S minus I. That is the difference from the dominant strategy equilibrium. That has been taken away. Not only that, this S minus I has been put up on this star. Okay? So, I come up with a profile of a strategy such that as long as everybody else other than me, if they are adhering to their action written down in this script, so this is a script, let us say. Think of it, this is the script. That each one of you, how you should behave. Somebody gave this script, right? Whatever is given in this script, everybody is adhering to their own recommendation, recommended action. Now, I am the smart guy, ith guy. I try to somehow cheat the system, okay? I come here and I say that, okay, while all my other friends are sticking to their respective choices recommended by, let's say, somebody, S minus I star, but I now try to see whether I can be better off by deviating, by taking some other action, okay? I am very selfish guy, actually. Although everybody is here, right, in this setup, okay? So I am selfish guy, so obviously that should not stop me to do this kind of deliberation, right? I should deliberate that, can I be better off by going from SI star to some other strategy, and if the answer turns out to be no, and that answer no is for every agent, very important, this answer should be no for every agent, then such a profile is called as pure strategy Nash equilibrium, okay? So let me repeat the statement, the difference between pure strategy Nash equilibrium and the strongly dominated Nash equilibrium which we talked previously. In pure strategy Nash equilibrium, we are first clamping a strategy profile, okay? Now we are taking one agent at a time and we are asking this question, if other than this agent, if everybody else stick to their prescribed strategy in this profile and if he is the only guy who is trying to deviate, this is typically called as a unilateral deviation. In that case, is he or she is going to get benefit out of such an act actually, right? Is it clear? And if the answer turns out to be no, see, it may be quite possible that if my opponents also change their stand, then I may get benefit by changing my stand. That's allowed here. Very important to see the point. The important point is my opponent first should be clamped on this recommended profile of the strategy. If, let's say, along with me, I found one of my friend, we try to cheat the system, and I tell him, okay, why don't we cooperate and let's try to do some sneaky things in the system. You do this, I'll do this, both will get benefit, right? That's possible. But here, in Nash equilibrium, the assumption is that nobody is cooperating. I'm not allowed to talk to anybody else and form the gang up with anybody else. Next talk will be about this ganging up, right? If what if you gang up? Then this may not be true, okay? So, the thing is that if I take this S minus I star, if I clamp it, and if agent I finds that he cannot be better off by switching to any other strategy, and this is true for every agent, then this is called a pure strategy Nash equilibrium. Tell me, is it clear or not? Very important definition, because over the next 2 days you are going to hear this word at least, I don't know how many number of times. In every talk, you will have this word uttering Nash equilibrium. Okay? So if you don't understand, I'll be the one to be blamed actually. I am the opening batsman here. So please let me know if nobody understands, because this is the so foundational stuff. Yeah, bolo. No. So I'll come. Good point. I'll come. So one important observation is, if some equilibrium is a strongly dominated equilibrium, that will also be Nash equilibrium. But other reverse way need not be true. For example, this case. This is a pure strategy Nash equilibrium also. Although it's a dominated Nash strategy equilibrium. Right? Dominant strategy equilibrium. So every dominant strategy equilibrium, which is a much stronger concept. So dominant strategy equilibrium is a much more stronger concept because it demands too many things. It demands that my system configuration should be in such a way that no matter what opponents does, I am always better off with one single strategy. And that should be true with every other player. It is demanding, it is putting too much constraint on the system design, which may not be true all the time. It just so happened that it was true in this example. So therefore, strongly dominated strategy equilibrium is very strong concept. If that happens, which means Nash has already happened, right? Obviously, in dominant strategy equilibrium, no agent has incentive to deviate no matter what others do. Then in that case, even if others stick to their dominant strategy, then also I don't have incentive, obviously, right? It's a much more demanding equilibrium concept, right? So maybe I forgot to mention, so that's why I put them in order, okay? So this dominant strategy equilibrium, if some strategy profile is dominant strategy equilibrium, that is also Nash equilibrium, you don't have to worry. But reverse is not true. A Nash equilibrium need not be a dominant strategy equilibrium. For example, let's go to that our ISC example, right? What was that? ISC and MG Road example. Let's take that example. Okay. So this is player one. This is player two. This is ISC. This is MG Road. And same is this ISC. And this is MG Road, let us say. So what were the payoffs? 100-100. Here I guess 10-10. Something like that, if you remember. 0-0, 0-0. So tell me, is there any dominant strategy for any of the player in this game? Let's ask this question. Is this strategy a dominant strategy for row player? Yes or no? Dominant strategy. First, let's ask dominant strategy. Suppose the player asks this question, irrespective of what my opponent is doing, am I better off taking this decision? This decision? I have two decisions, right? Go to ISC or go to MG Road. Am I always better off going to ISC, irrespective of what opponent does? No, right? Because if I blindly decide that I'll go to ISC, I will be better off only if my partner goes to ISC. But I'll be worse off if my partner goes to MG Road. Do you see the point? It's not a dominant strategy. Same is with the case with MG Road. If I decide to go to MG Road, I am better off subject to the condition that my partner also goes to MG Road. Otherwise, I would have been better off in going with ISC, right? If my partner chooses to go to ISC, I am in fact worse off, strictly worse off, right? Make sense? Digest it slowly. And maybe make note of it, you can think about it. Same argument, line of argument will apply with player two also, that none of these two strategies dominant strategy. So there is no dominant strategy equilibrium in this case, right? For dominant strategy equilibrium to happen, you first have to have dominant strategy of each of the player. There is no dominant strategy of any of the player, there is no question of dominant strategy equilibrium. However, let's ask this question, is there a Nash equilibrium? So what is the definition of Nash equilibrium? Go back, let's try to confirm that. And by the way, mind you that this qualifier is very important. I am calling this as a pure strategy Nash equilibrium. There is something called mixed strategy Nash equilibrium. I'll come to that in a minute. What is pure strategy Nash equilibrium? That some profile, some recommendation, some prescribed protocol, such that if everybody else adhere to that protocol, but if I try to act smart, I'm going to lose actually. That's the only idea. Okay? So here, let's try to see. Suppose this is the protocol. So S is equal to S1 equal to ISC and S2 equal to ISC. Suppose each one of them have locked down to this choice. This is one profile, right? One strategy profile. Tell me whether this is a Nash equilibrium. Right? Is it right? Because this is my S1 star. Suppose if this is my S2 star, if I am the player one, if my this opponent stick to this strategy, then I am no better off by changing strategy other than what is recommended, right? So is the case with this player. So now if I clamp this player's strategy and if I deliberate from the point of view of player two, there is no point in changing. It is a Nash equilibrium, pure strategy Nash equilibrium. Although we saw that there is no dominant strategy, right? How about this cell? How about this cell? Again, pure strategy Nash equilibrium. So this is pure strategy Nash equilibrium. This is also pure strategy Nash equilibrium, this profile. How about this cell? Is it a pure strategy Nash equilibrium? So let's analyze. So suppose this S1 star IISC and S2 star is MG Road. Okay. Now, as per the definition of Nash equilibrium, assumption is, suppose player one is analyzing his situation. So we have to claim to the other player at their prescribed strategy as per this plan. So I have to claim player 2 at this plan. So player 1 knows that everybody else has, are adhering to their recommendation. Now player 1 sees there is a benefit to switching to MG road. So clearly, because there is a benefit, this is not a stable system. This is not an equilibrium. So this is not a Nash equilibrium. In fact, you will see that by switching, he moves back to this strategy, which is the Nash equilibrium. Pure strategy Nash equilibrium. Make sense? So what did we learn? That a dominant strategy equilibrium, okay, is always a Nash equilibrium, but reverse need not be true. Okay? We saw in this example. All right? Whereas in the case of prisoner's dilemma, what was happening? Both was Nash equilibrium as well as dominant strategy. Look at this. Is this a Nash equilibrium? We saw that it's a dominant strategy equilibrium. Let's just argue, is it a Nash equilibrium? So, suppose S star, S1 star is equal to C, S2 star equal to C. Let's try to analyze that, is this Nash equilibrium or not as per the definition of Nash equilibrium? So first claim all other player, then only one player, single player. In this case, there are just two players, so I claim everybody else other than, let's say, player one. So if she's claimed or he's claimed at C, what is the best strategy for him to go? Tell me, is it Nash equilibrium? I think this number has changed, right? Yeah, now you see. Right? So if this person has been claimed to C, it's best interest to go for C. Same is with this actually. So this is also a Nash equilibrium. By definition, you can prove it. But there is a standard, very simple result. You can show that if it's a dominant strategy equilibrium, you don't have to do all these proofs and all. It's a directly follows actually. Okay? Okay, let's move on. How about this traffic example? Okay? So let's say there is no link in between. Suppose there is no link in between, okay? What will be the equilibrium behavior that somebody told, right? You guys only answered. 2,000 people going from the upper path, 2,000 people going from the bottom path. Is it a Nash equilibrium or it's a dominant strategy equilibrium? First of all, let's talk about Nash equilibrium. Is it a Nash equilibrium? So there are 4,000 people. Every person has a choice, go up or go down. Take upper link or take the bottom link. These are the two choices, right? Half of the people have taken, this is the prescribed protocol where, so if you want to write it, let's say, I'll write it this manner. So S star equal to S1 star, S2 star, up to S 2000 people, first 2000 players, they are taking this route C, okay? Then S 2001, 2002, all the way up to 4,000th player. There are total 4,000 agents, right? They are taking D. So this is one strategy profile, right? This is one behavior profile. I'm giving you who is logged on to what choice. First 2,000 agents have logged on to the choice, namely C, which is the upper route. Remaining 2,000 agents have been logged to their choice D. This is one, let's say, suggested way of behaving all of you. Now, do you think in this way of behaving, if all 3,999 agents stick to their strategy, but there is one weird guy, IS player, if that fellow decides to switch, okay, go either from top route to the bottom route, will that person will benefit it? Let's analyze actually. So, what is happening here? So, so this is 45 fixed delay, this is 45 fixed delay, or maybe I have taken the other way around. Let's put x by 100. Doesn't matter, this is a symmetric thing. Okay, so now 2000 people are traveling on this, 2000 people are traveling on this. Let's say there is some weird guy, IS agent actually, who decides to go from here to here. What will be his delay? Currently, what is his delay? So the current delay, or let's just call it as delay of ith agent equal to how much? 2000 divided by 100 plus 45, which we saw is 65, right? Now suppose this ith agent decides to move on this link. That's the only choice, right? Everybody else is sticking to their where they are. But he's the only weird guy who is moving. What will be his new delay? New delay. Or I, can you see this? Or I'll write. So this new delay for I equal, how much it would be? Do you agree with this? How much it will be? 65 point, which is more than this actually. So am I improving or worsening? Worsening, right? I shouldn't go. Same analysis apply for any agent I. Nobody will be better off unless you have some partners, okay? You tell bunch of the guys to switch from bottom link to top and you switch from top to bottom until multiple guys switch their current locking strategy, till then you are not going to see any advantage. So this is a pure strategy Nash equilibrium. Is it a dominant strategy Nash equilibrium, by the way? No, right? Why? Think about it. Think about these things, okay? And does there any dominant strategy Nash equilibrium exist in this game? Just as an exercise, you should think, okay? What if I put a link? Now this game has changed, right? Now, you remember we saw that everybody will get onto this link and everybody suffer more delay, right? What was that delay? So 4,000 here, 4,000 here, 80 minutes delay, right? As opposed to 65 here, okay? Now, let's find out whether this is the Nash equilibrium, because it seems very counterintuitive. Government opened a new link, everybody is using that new link, the overall health should improve of the society. But our analysis says that if everybody takes this link, everybody will suffer, right? The moment I know that everybody will suffer, I try to cheat. Okay, now why don't I just take from move away from the crowd behavior? And I go back to my this choice. Let's say I am only one guy. So what will be my delay? So, you see my point? So there are 4,000 people now traveling on this link. So now this new link has come, which has zero delay. 4,000 people are traveling on this link. There is a one weird guy who now takes from, what is the choice? It's symmetric game anyway. So either you go, so obviously if he goes from here to here, let us say, he will incur how much? 90 minutes? 90 minutes anyway is worse than his current time. So obviously this is not the choice for him to take, even though it is a zero delay. So the only choice, which currently he is taking this path, right? The only alternative path could be either this or this, right? It could be even this also actually, but they are symmetric, doesn't matter actually. So if you take this path, how much will be the delay now? 4,000 anyway will be continuing to be here. Here, 45 minutes. So 4,000 plus 45 minutes, 85 minutes. And currently how much delay you have? 80 minutes. So even if unilaterally you change here, that's not going to help you. So this behavior is a Nash equilibrium behavior, okay? The entire crowd going to this link, this is a Nash equilibrium behavior of the entire system. Is it clear? Okay, so maybe then in the interest of time, again this we discussed, CC is a Nash equilibrium, and there are two pure strategy Nash equilibrium. These two we discussed actually, both of them are pure strategy Nash equilibrium. There is something called one mixed strategy Nash equilibrium, so that's what I'm going to quickly define. I don't have more time, so I'll just quickly give you the definition. There is this something called mixed strategy Nash equilibrium, okay? There are certain games in which there may not exist any pure strategy. There may not obviously exist any dominant strategy, because if Nash does not exist, dominant cannot exist, obviously, right? Because if dominant had existed, that would have been Nash, obviously. So if Nash does not exist, okay, okay. So if Nash does not exist, then dominant cannot exist. That pure strategy Nash equilibrium may not exist in all the games. I don't have, unfortunately, that example. There is the famous example called matching pennies example. Let me give you, I think I can cook up that example. So it's like matching pennies. The people, two people have the coin, let's say $1 coin, and we just put them on the table simultaneously. After that we see. If both of them are head or both of them are tail, the person one wins. If there is a different sign, then person two wins. And the person who wins takes the coin, both the coins. So what will be the game? What will be the game? So, so let's say head and tail, head and tail. So I have a coin. I have to put it on the table. You also have a coin. you also have to put at the table, and we cannot see what you are putting. After putting, we will remove our hands, actually. So you have two choices, either put head up or the tail up. And we will see if the things are matching. So if both are head, let's say player one wins. So what will be the payoff of player one? $2, right? And if both are tail, then also player one wins, right? But if this is 0-2 and 0-2, right? I think if I'm not wrong, this is the example of matching penny. Can you correct me? Is it correct example? Doesn't matter, actually. There's a constant I have added. Tell me, is there any dominant strategy equilibrium? Is there any dominant strategy, first of all? Am I better off by putting always showing head, no matter what my opponent does? Is it the case? So if I blindly, unilaterally, I say that I'll put always head up, I may lose, right? If my opponent puts the tail, actually. So head is not a dominant strategy for me. So is tail. None of these two are a dominant strategy. And even for other player also, both of them are not dominant strategy. So there is no dominant strategy equilibrium. Clear? Let's see whether there is a pure strategy Nash equilibrium. Let's try to deliberate. Is it a pure strategy Nash equilibrium? So S1 star is H and S2 star is H. Now, let's try to analyze. If it were to be Nash equilibrium, then unilateral deviation should not help. Let's clamp S2. S2 continues to pick H. Then is it in best interest for S1 to player 1 to pick H? Yes. So far, so good. But now if I clamp this guy, if he decides to pick H actually, is it the best strategy for 2 to pick H? No. Right? He'll be better off by deviating. So here is one culprit who is better off by deviating than the prescribed strategy, namely H, H. So it is not a Nash equilibrium. Analysis is very symmetric. Again, in a symmetric manner, this is also not a pure strategy Nash equilibrium. Right? Is it a, again, you can argue, it's a very symmetric game actually. So you can just argue that none of them is a pure strategy Nash equilibrium. So this is one scenario, one example, which is obvious, right? I mean, some of you have played this game. If two of us play the game, we have to put the coin, head and tail. What would be your strategy? Think in a common sense. Do you think putting always head, you will be better off? Suppose we repeat this game many times, suppose. If you are so blind that you put head, my opponent will learn within no time and he will always put tail, right? And take my all money actually, right? Or vice versa. So neither I should always go with head, nor I should always go with tail. What should I do then? Randomize, okay? The moment I don't randomize, I am losing the battle to my opponent. Opponent knows that actually. That's precisely the point called mixed strategy Nash equilibrium. So what is mixed strategy Nash equilibrium? So given a player I with SI as the set of pure strategy, a mixed strategy, also called as a randomized strategy, we denote by sigma I, lots of notations now for you to digest. So sigma I of player I is a probability distribution over SI, okay? So think of that, there is a big basket in which you put all your strategies and shuffled it with, and then put your hand and draw it randomly, right? Which means first you toss a coin, if head comes then you put head, if tail comes then you put tail actually, let's say this way. So obviously then it's not all the time I'll be losing and all the time I'll be winning. In which case probably half of the time I'll be winning, half of the time opponent will be winning, and we are like having a 0-0 equilibrium, right? I mean 0-0 net worth actually, which is better than all the time losing to opponent for either of the player actually. So the sigma I is a distribution which will be a mapping going from each of the pure strategies. So capital SI is my set of pure strategy. So with each pure strategy, I attach a number between 0 and 1. This is called with what probability I am going to play with this this strategy. So for example, in this traffic example, if you were to take a mixed strategy, what will you do? On any day when you wake up, you first toss a coin. If head comes, you say that today I'll travel on the upper route. If tail comes, then you decide I'll travel on the bottom route. This is called mixed strategy. This is the way of implementing. I'm just giving you a very simple anecdotal way of understanding these concepts actually, right? If you can't understand in more mathy form. Okay, so this is called a pure strategy, and this probability, obviously this is a probability, so if I sum it up over all possible, all pure strategy in this set, it should sum to one actually. Make sense? All right. Why we are doing all this fancifulness? Because we want to do mixed extension of the pure strategy game. So far we have seen that this game was number of player, the set of player, utility of each player, and this, in this triple, there was set of pure strategies, right? Now this delta SI is little bit complicated quantity, it's a probability simplex. So set of all possible probability which I can induce, all possible ways of choosing, let's say between two choices, right? It's not just 50%, 50%. I could have chosen 30% of the time I take the upper route and 70% of the time I take the bottom path. Similarly, in matching penny game, I could have taken that 30% of the time I'll be putting head. I'll randomly shuffle. I'll have a bias coin. I'll flip the bias coin, which 30% of the time comes head, 70% of the time comes tail, and accordingly I'll go. That could have been another mixed strategy, right? So what mixed strategy is, first of all, set of all possible ways of randomizing my few strategies. That is called set of mixed strategy, and we denote it by this delta SI. So every member of delta SI, this is a set. Every member of delta SI is one valid probability distribution over the pure strategy. Is it clear? So those who still want to understand, so suppose in this case, let's say player 1, S1, in this example I am saying, this S1 has two strategies, head and tail. Now, what will be the delta S1? So delta S1 will be denoted by probability P, 1 minus P in this case, because there are only two choices. If there were three choices, you would have to induce where P itself could be a number in the interval 0 to 1. This is called mixed strategy set. So if you take one specific P value, that will give you one mixed strategy. If you take some different value of P, that will give you some different mixed strategy. Okay? So P is the lever with which you can decide. Like earlier, we were just picking one of the pure strategy. Now I will pick one value of P. That is equivalent to picking one mixed strategy. Okay. So now, if you modified the notion of strategy, you also have to modify the notion of utility. So how does the notion of utility go? Now we talk about the expected utility, right? Because the moment everybody is randomizing over their decisions, the overall system gets randomized, right? So every possible profile of the decision also gets randomized. Like in this case, this S1, S2 will be taken with certain probability. So under each of them, you multiply the utility with its corresponding probability, joint probability, okay? This is called the modified utility. So this modified setup is called mixed extension of the pure strategy game. Now, maybe this is almost, we are towards the end. So given a strategic form game, a mixed strategy profile is called as a Nash equilibrium. I'm not calling it as a pure strategy Nash equilibrium. This is now called as a mixed strategy Nash equilibrium. And by the way, is pure strategy a special case of a mixed strategy? Yes, because if I put entire probability mass on one of the strategy, you have a question? Yeah, okay. So if I put entire probability mass on one specific pure strategy, that's a valid probability distribution, but then it boils down to a pure strategy. So set of pure strategy is can be achieved as a special cases of set of mixed strategy. So we are even moving towards generalization. So previous discussion is subsumed in all this. So what we say is a mixed strategy profile is Nash equilibrium if the following happen, that if everybody else sticks to their randomization, if I am the only one who deliberate that should I change little different way of randomizing my actions and I realize that my expected payoff is not going to be better off, then I call that this is a mixed strategy Nash equilibrium. Clear? So with this, I come to almost an end, and here is the picture of Professor John Nash. So he proved this is a fantastic result, right? Very, very profound result. It may sound very simple, just one line. Every finite strategic form game has at least one mixed strategy Nash equilibrium. Takes just one line to read and write, but you will see in the afternoon it's quite non-trivial proof. Okay? So what it says, let me just give you the gist of it. It says that give me a finite game, which means number of players are finite, the set of strategy of each player is finite, and now I allow agents to mix. I mean, allow agents to randomize while taking the decision, they can toss a coin and then decide. Then, always there exists some way of mixing of the strategy for each player, which will put them, which will lock them into equilibrium behavior. Means that there exists some way of, prescribed way of mixing the strategy for each player, such that no player will be benefiting by moving away from that particular way of mixing the strategy. Is it clear? In simple English, I am articulating. is fancy maths and all you can find in any book. There are more number of books on game theory than number theory, probably, right? Okay, so why this is so important? Because this concept is so important because it helps you predict the behavior of the agents who are put up in a non-cooperative setup. So players are happy the way they are, okay, obviously, and they do not want to deviate unilaterally. And it provides a principled way of predicting the steady state outcome of a dynamic adjustment process, right? Like we saw that, okay? This is also a stable self-enforcing and self-sustaining agreement. Nobody is forcing anybody, like in the traffic example. All of you guys, after doing hit and trial, you'll all realize, boss, this is the best way to live life, actually. There's no point in doing any mimicry because we are going to lose at the end. Let's come to an equilibrium, like how political parties do it after doing so many tussles here and there. Finally, they settle at some equilibrium, right? And so, but this need not be the part is that this need not be socially optimal. We saw that, right? In this, they end up, these poor fellows end up going to jail for 5 years, whereas there was a choice for 2 years. We also see that country don't invest heavily on nuclear armaments, even though we have a choice that if nobody invests in nuclear armament, life would be very happy. But that's not how the reality is, right? So Nash equilibrium gives you the way why in real life the work the way it works actually, right? An innocent kid may ask, why are we inventing these nuclear arms actually? Why are we in arm race? For a kid, that may be a very genuine question. But to answer that, yes, this is the reason, you have to see that it's my threat actually. If I don't protect myself, the other person is going to attack me, right? That's the reason actually, okay? And that's what Nash equilibria theory, a very profound theory to analyze these situations. Maybe I'll just skip some of them. Okay, these are some of the stalwarts. So the left-hand side are this lots of, among them, many of them are Nobel laureates. So here is Roger Myerson, and this is von Neumann, Lord Shapley, John Nash. Many of them have won, almost all of them have won the Nobel Prize in economics. On the right-hand side, these are the legendary figures in computer science. So what I wanted to say is that there has been, past 10 years has seen a huge amount of synergy between economic sciences and computer science, primarily because of this Nash equilibrium. So one thing which I did not tell you, let me go back. So the computing this Nash equilibrium, right? We have defined that this Nash equilibrium exists. But how do I find it? Given a situation, given a game, can somebody come and tell me what is the Nash equilibrium? Can machine find it actually? That's the question computer scientists started asking, and still the exploration is on. Then it goes into all kinds of hardness problem, that what kind of complexity class this problem belongs to, etc. So last 10 years and maybe more than 10 years have been very, very fruitful period for having marriage between these two disciplines, and conferences like, you know, ACM1 and things have come out of some of this work. Maybe I'll just end with this book, very interesting book, very friendly book by Professor Nareri on Introduction to Game Theory. Also written more from the point of view of CS student, because there are lots of examples which, you know, you can connect with your CS problems, like job scheduling problems on servers, etc., printer scheduling problems, traffic routing problem, networks routing problem. If you are interested, you can look at this book actually, right? Okay, maybe I should stop here, that's all. Thank you. If any more question, we can take, otherwise.